In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, Amen. My Lord and my God, I firmly believe that you are here, that you see me, that you hear me. I adore you with profound reverence. I ask you pardon for my sins and the grace to spend this time of prayer fruitfully. My Immaculate Mother, Saint Joseph, my Father and Lord, my guardian angel, intercede for me. As we were considering the other day, the first readings of the masses, the weekday masses of these days, had been about the adventure, if we may call it that, of Moses. The accounts of Exodus, the flight of the chosen people from the land of the Pharaohs, from Egypt, in order to return to the promised land. Central figures were, of course, Moses and Aaron. Although Moses and Aaron performed various wonders in Pharaoh's presence, we read today, the Lord made Pharaoh obstinate, and he would not let the children of Israel leave his land. One wonders, because after everything, all the plagues that God sent through Moses and through Aaron, can you imagine turning the Nile to blood and all the water sources to blood, or that plague of locusts that destroyed all the grain of Egypt, or those snakes and scorpions and frogs? It's terrible. And yet Pharaoh said no, obstinately, I will not let you go. To Moses repeated, let my people go, being the mouthpiece of God, Pharaoh had said no. We can stop right there, because we can apply that same lesson to what's happening nowadays. Consider this plague that we're suffering from at the moment. I'm referring to the pandemic. One would have thought that in a situation like this, people would be more introspect. Powers that be would be more, shall we say, receptive to divine providence, to the reality of things happening which are beyond their control. And so therefore, the normal thing would be to get down on one's knees and to pray, or at least to re-examine the terms of engagement that the people had been using up to now, and not just work for getting back to the old grind. They keep on talking about the new normal, but if you look at the new normal that people are talking about, it's actually the old ways still. The same materialism, the same lust for power, the same political agenda, the same family dynasties, the same. So when we read these things of Pharaoh, we shouldn't be surprised. Because really, that's the hardness of the human heart. What we have been suffering since day one. Actually, that's nothing compared to what Adam and Eve did. Because we say, sometimes we think, no? I mean, the great evils that we do, but you know, for somebody who's already sick to get a little bit more sick or sicker, it's not really such a big thing. You're already dirty, you get dirty some more. It's not a big thing. But Adam and Eve were integral human nature. They were in paradise. Everything was running like clockwork in paradise. For them to do good, for them to live their lives as God wanted was the most natural thing, should have been the most spontaneous thing. And yet they said, no, it's the mystery of iniquity. Mysterium iniquitatis, as the writers of centuries have referred to it. How an intelligent being, because it's not just man, also the angels at the beginning, some of them anyway, how an intelligent person, knowing the worth of things, and therefore the omnipotence, or rather the infinite goodness of God, compared to any other created reality, including himself, would rather sacrifice God for his own pleasure, for his own standard, for his own whim. Because actually that was whimsical, if you consider, for the angel to say, I would not serve. What is that? You know very well the consequences of that action. That's the rejection of the infinite goodness of God, and their, shall we say, condemnation, their resignation to a fate away from that goodness of God. And yet they did it. And our first parents the same. From a life of intimacy with God, of happiness in his presence, of just playing by the book, so to speak, because the book was so nice anyway. God's playbook was so good. It was paradise, precisely. It was a garden of pleasure. And even God himself found joy. Delitia mea se filiominum, that my delight was to be with the children of men, ludens in orbita rarum, playing in the confines of the earth. And that was the state of original justice. And so what went on in the mind of our first parents to say, no, thanks, but no thanks. I'd rather go my own way. But let's not wonder too much, because we feel it in our own cases, in our own lives. That rebellion, which is what pride is. That non servium of Satan that has echoed through the centuries in all of the history of mankind. What Pharaoh was doing was just another manifestation of that. But let's try to understand it a bit more. What was it that Pharaoh was protecting, not letting the Israelites go? Anything about it? What advantage, what gain was he getting from them? Well, free labor. They were slaves, remember? They had been enslaved. And he was building statues, pyramids, tombs with that free labor. And, well, I have mentioned it. Remember, he was throwing away all the male, but conserving the females. To enslave them too, and to, of course, make use of them as female slaves, whatever that would entail. So in other words, it was self-gain, it was pleasure, it was material things, as somebody would say, same-o, same-o. The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, the threefold concupiscence, classic causes, or reasons rather, because it's not really a cause, because sin has no cause. It's the absence of a due cause, precisely. That's what evil is. But rather, the occasions, the reasons why man falls into sin. And that's the reason why, since I'm immemorial, I was about to say, but at least from the beginning of Christianity, we have always been taught that we need to struggle against ourselves, to struggle against our fallen nature. And an integral part of this struggle is what is mentioned as the first of the Beatitudes. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for they shall inherit the earth. For theirs is the kingdom of heaven, rather. Poverty, detachment. Because at the end of the day, it's the attachment to material things, it's the attachment to sensual pleasure. In other words, to temporal goods that makes man sacrifice friendship with God. Our life on earth is a journey towards love. We have to keep that in mind. Love of God and love of all souls whom we desire to bring to God. But as a result of original sin, the human will has disordered tendency towards self-love and towards seeking personal satisfaction out of all the goods that God has placed in the universe, actually for our enjoyment, but our enjoyment in His service, our enjoyment according to the rules of engagement that He Himself has established. When this attraction to material things and the temporal realities are kept under rational control according to the commandments of God, then everything is good. As we were considering in the past meditation, God takes no pleasure in making us suffer, period. But yes, it's not good to find pleasure in a disorderly way. It's utterly wrong to sacrifice the love of God in order to steep ourselves, to wallow rather, in the pleasures of this earth. Our struggle, Saint Jose Maria was saying once, has a battlefront within us, the battlefront of our passions. That's why the vigilant soul wages constant interior war against the occasions of sin or against anything that weakens faith, erodes hope, or debases love. Every human being is under severe pressure, he said, ably fostered by the devil to avoid thinking about eternal destiny. Don't forget that sin, which according to the old theological masters is a turning away from God and turning towards creatures, begins to creep into the soul precisely through disordered attachments and a tendency to enjoy the good things of this earth, to feed its earthly ambitions to the point of forgetting about God and the end for which it was created. Nowadays, there is a universal tendency to center everything on man. We're living in a materialistic atmosphere which pays no heed to man's transcendental vocation. Vocation to eternity, our vocation to the infinite good, to the ultimate good who is God, and cruelly stifles the freedom of the human person, or at least confuses freedom with permissiveness, while commercializing human passions. It is depressing to see droves of people allowing themselves to be dictated to by a small number of individuals who impose their own dogmas, myths, and indeed a whole desacralized ritual. My brothers and sisters, we cannot be impervious to these realities. Or so irresponsibly, I don't know what, like that, like what they say a heron does, or an ostrich does, rather burying his head in the sand to hide from its enemy while the rest of its body is still there. How, can you imagine how silly that is? Which is what happens when we allow ourselves to be carried by the current without, shall we say, criticizing or engage in critical thinking of whether things are really right or whether they're wrong. We're living in a world that people have lost their moral compass. Actually, there's a term for it. It's the self-esteem syndrome, that personal well-being has become the standard of right and wrong. For as long as we feel good about it, it's good. And if we don't feel good about it, then it's not good. So the highest value is to feel good about ourselves and about things. And can you imagine how, you know, utterly nonsensical that is, if you think about it? We are not the center of the universe. Neither are we the author of nature. There is a God. There is an author of creation. There is a creator. And the way he created things is the way they are. The problem with humanity is that because of all the scientific and technological advancements that we have had, all gifts of God, by the way, who has given us the intellect and the raw materials for all that progress, after all, he said, subdue the earth. But precisely in the process of subduing the earth, it has gotten to our head. To the point that just because we can do something, we forget to ask ourselves if we ought to do it. Like the Pharaoh, he could do it. He could command all of those things. Can you imagine making the Israelites make bricks? They used to provide them with straw because, you know, you make bricks. Those are the way they made bricks in that civilization. It was not to bake it. They were sun-dried bricks. Imagine, how do you make sun-dried bricks strong? A little bit more of tensile strength. But they mix them with straw. Not the very soft straw, but the part of the stalk which is more fibrous, like cane. But okay, fine. That's the way they were doing it. But then just to prove a point, just to be more cruel, he withdrew the supply of straw and make them forage for it themselves, just to make it tougher for them, more difficult for them to make those bricks in order to make those monuments. That's what happened. Just because he could do it, he did it. How many things like that we do nowadays, or humanity is subjected to nowadays? Just because people can do it, then they do it. But feasibility is not the standard for human action. Right and wrong is the standard of human action. The will of God is the standard of human action. The way he has created the universe is the standard of human action. We need to combat this tendency with the resources of Christian doctrine in a persevering and worldwide catechesis. Bear in mind, my daughters and sons, he was speaking to his daughters and sons in Opus Dei, that the interior struggle cannot be reduced to mere human asceticism. It is a logical consequence of the truths that God has revealed about himself, about our human condition, and our mission in the world. Without that interior battle, without sharing in our Lord's passion, no one can follow the Master. Perhaps that is why we're witnessing this disgraceful stampede. Many people seem to think they can combine a purely worldly lifestyle with following Christ, without the cross and without suffering. That is not possible. Without substantially altering our Redeemer's message, for the disciple is not above his master. Christ's disciple must be ready to deny himself and lose his life for the salvation of others. He who wishes to come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow me. This is asceticism, Christian asceticism. Definitely, for the worldly, it doesn't make sense. Why should I make myself suffer? Why should I complicate my life? Why should I deny myself these pleasures? All of those terms are partly true. But it's also false, because it's not the statement of the complete picture. Why should I make myself suffer? Only if my appetite for something wrong Anybody knows this, if you already have high cholesterol, then you go to a party and they have lechon and they have, then you deny yourself that thing. Why will I make myself suffer? Everybody's enjoying themselves. Or somebody with a sweet tooth, but already has elevated sugar. So you make yourself suffer because your appetites are a bit out of whack. If they were in sync, if they were orderly, then there's no need to make yourself suffer. The virtuous person, by the way, after all this ascetical struggle, when somebody has really developed the virtues, finds doing the right thing enjoyable and doing the wrong thing repugnant. But before getting there, it's like, again, going back to the example of the athlete. Now, an athletic person finds joy in running or in swimming, getting his heart rate at levels that normally another person would be gasping for breath. Because he has tuned himself, trained himself to that shape, to that level of fitness. Something happens in the spiritual life. To carry the cross. Yeah, of course, there's something costly about carrying the cross, but you don't just carry the cross to make yourself suffer. We carry the cross. What cross is that? The cross of setting things aright, the price of helping the others, as we were talking the other day, of being a good citizen. You know, it's not easy to segregate garbage. It's much simpler just to throw it. But hey, we're trying to help the environment. We're trying to help garbage collection. We're trying to recycle things. So we segregate. Any householder, any responsible father or mother knows that the system, the best system to do in the house is that, okay, people put away their dishes. Even just putting things in the dishwasher, for example, if you use a dishwasher, it's a lot simpler if people, not everybody can be there putting into the dishwasher, right? And so people take turns. But there's a system for putting things in the dishwasher. Take away all the food particles, stack the dishes so as not to cover the outlet for the cleaning fluid, etc., etc. All of those are complications. Yeah, but in the end, it makes things work. Virtue, remember, is defined as the habit, the stable disposition for doing the right thing. When we have developed that virtue, then doing the right thing becomes unnatural to a person. The orderly person just does things in an orderly way. So I always say, you have a room which is disordered, put an orderly person there, and in the course of just living his normal life on a day-to-day basis, slowly that environment gets ordered. Because perhaps the first day, okay, he will be really contradicted by so much disorder, but every time he uses something, which by the way, he will have to look for because it's disordered, then after he has used it, he will put it in a logical place where it should be. Little by little, the whole thing gets orderly. On the other hand, the reverse that, get an orderly place and put a disorderly person there, and in no time at all, the whole thing is a mess. What's the big difference? One has the virtue of order, the other one doesn't. I say of order, I say of purity, I say of poverty, I say of so many other things. So it's a question. Christian asceticism kicking in. It's a question of developing virtues until we get into the stable disposition of doing the right thing. What is that actually? Isn't that a return to the original order? A return to the order wanted by God in paradise? Definitely, that's almost like utopia. It's not going to happen totally, but we can approximate it. And it's that effort to approximate ourselves to that that orients our life to God. The effort of doing the good, even if we're failing or we're not actually succeeding 100% because of so many other externalities, but morally, personally, our will is pointed in the right direction. And if we die in that state, then we go to God. That verse is true for somebody who's not struggling. Even if perhaps because of, you know, the way things are, it's not so bad, but his will is not directed towards God. It's tangential. And when he dies, he cannot go to God that way. That's what purgatory is for. And if really is so off the track, then maybe he'll miss God altogether. And that's what hell is all about. My Lord, when you were explaining these things to the apostles, to your disciples, many of them must have at first been amazed or flabbergasted with what you were talking about. Imagine the Sermon on the Mount, the demands that our Lord said there. But you must have done it in such a way that you were almost irresistible. I say almost, because remember that even Judas resisted up to the last moment. And some of those disciples stopped following him too. But to those who opened their hearts to your message, Lord, those who were willing to follow you and pay the price of carrying their cross, they soon found out that at the end of the day, it wasn't that difficult. And the reason is very simple, really. Because human nature is not rotten. It's just defective. It's just been damaged a bit. All it needs is just some fine-tuning, some tweaking. But the thing is, we have to do it. It's much easier to be a saint than to train yourself for the marathon or to be a triathlete. Because whereas not everyone genetically might have really the genes to run a good marathon or to be a triathlete, which means to say to be able to run a marathon and to run a marathon, to bike 160 kilometers and to swim 8 kilometers or at least 5, not everyone will have the genes for that. But everyone, absolutely everyone, was made by God to go to heaven. We have what it takes. So, let's take this thing seriously and come to terms with it. Our life must be a struggle, but it's a struggle that's doable. It's a struggle that's accompanied by the saints, by a guardian angel, by a blessed mother. And we have all the means at our disposal, the sacraments, prayer life, sacred scripture. This is our destiny on earth, St. Guru Maria said, to struggle for love up to the last moment. We have about a few minutes left to finish the prayer. Thank you.